हेलो गाइस, टुडे वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट द ग्लाइकोलाइसिस. सॉरी फॉर द स्पेलिंग. सो ग्लाइको मीन्स ग्लूकोज एंड लाइसिस मीन इट्स ब्रेक डाउन. सो लेट वी विल लुक अबाउट द ओवरव्यू ऑफ ग्लाइकोलाइसिस. एज वी नो द ग्लाइकोलाइसिस टेक प्लेस इन ऑल द सेल्स एंड इट्स लोकेशन इज इट अकर्स इनसाइड द साइटोप्लाज्म. सो आरबीसी हेयर प्लेज एन इम्पोर्टेंट रोल because the RBC depends entirely on the glucose for its survival. And what type of glycolysis takes place here? The anaerobic glycolysis takes place in RBCs because it lacks mitochondria. Because of that, the aerobic glycolysis can take place inside the RBCs because the oxidative phosphorylation will be absent in that case if the mitochondria will be absent, because the aerobic glycolysis takes place in a mitochondrial membrane. So you might have got a question strike in your mind that why we are studying the glycolysis, what's the purpose of the glycolysis. So as I have said that RBCs entirely depends on the glycolysis. So any defect in glycolytic enzyme will lead to the effect in RBCs too. So if any defect occur in the glycolytic enzyme, then it will lead to the hemolysis. And why hemolysis will occur? Because of the glycolytic enzymes inside the RBCs. Along with RBC, an important organ that is skeletal muscles also play an important role during glycolysis. So why skeletal muscle? Suppose we are doing a severe exercise, so during severe exercise we will be lack of oxygen. So in that case, what is the source of energy? So in that case, the glycolysis, the anaerobic one here, anaerobic glycolysis will take place. So ischemia means oxygen shortage. So then ischemia, the anaerobic glycolysis will take place so that it can provide us energy to do that exercise continuously. So let it write down here. So in skeletal muscles, as I have said, there is a enormous capacity for the glycolysis because it's the major organ, and in ischemia there will be the anaerobic glycolysis will take place. So guys, we have seen the two things here, the RBCs and the skeletal muscles, which can survive without the oxygen. But you know, there are some other tissues which cannot survive in the lack of oxygen. Suppose brain and heart. So heart cannot survive without the oxygen. So heart cannot survive in the ischemia. So that is why the oxygen is mandatory for the brain and the heart muscle, that is the cardiac muscles. So let it note down here that the heart cannot survive in the ischemia. So till now we have just discussed the overview of the glycolysis, like where it takes place and in what conditions. So now we will see when glycolysis takes place. So glycolysis takes place in a well-fed state under the influence of the insulin hormone, which is secreted by the beta cells of the islet of Langerhans of the pancreas. So in well-fed state means, suppose we had just had a chocolate or we just had a meal. So that means that in postprandial conditions, the glycolysis will take place under the influence of the insulin. So let it write down here. So glycolysis takes place in a well-fed state under the influence of the insulin hormone. So now we will see the just overview of how glucose metabolizes inside the body. So glucose is a 6-carbon compound, and under the influence of some enzymes, it will break down into the 3-carbon compounds, such as DHAP means dihydroacetone phosphate, which is 3rd-carbon compound, and into the glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. Glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, which is also a 3-carbon compound. So this glycerol and one more point is here, the DHAP and glyceraldehyde is a irreversible compound. So glyceraldehyde will be converted into the pyruvate further, and pyruvate will get into the Krebs cycle by the forming of the acetyl coenzyme A, which will enter into the TCA cycle. and it will takes place under the aerobic conditions. In anaerobic condition, the pyruvate will be degraded into the lactate under the influence of the anaerobic conditions. So pyruvate will takes place in acetyl coenzyme in the aerobic conditions under the influence of pyruvate dehydrogenase, while it will convert it into the lactate in anaerobic condition in the presence of LDH, that is the lactate dehydrogenase. So it was just the basic overview of the glycolysis. Now we will read it in the detail. So the steps of the glycolysis, which are total 10 in number. So we will divide it into the two phases. That is, first one is the preparatory phase, which is also 5 in number. And second one is the payoff phase, which is also 5 in number. So the preparatory phase is also known as the stage of phosphorylation, because phosphorylation will take place here, and it's the stage of splitting and the utilizing of ATP, because we use the ATP here, and stage of splitting because the six carbon compound, that is glucose, will be splitting into the three carbon compound, that is the DHAP and glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. On other hand, the payoff phase is also known as the stage of oxidation and reduction, because the NADH will be produced here and that it generates the ATP. So ATP will generate here. So let's read them one by one. The first one is the preparatory phase, which is also known as the stage of phosphorylation. So what happens here? The glucose will be converted into the glucose 6-phosphate. The glucose will enter into the cell and it will convert it into the glucose 6-phosphate under the enzyme, that is the hexokinase and glucokinase. The glucokinase will be the major enzyme in case of the liver, while in other tissues the hexokinase will be the major enzyme because of the Km values, that is the Michaelis constant. The Km value for hexokinase is low, means it has the high affinity for glucose. Means if the glucose concentration even is low, then the hexokinase can convert it into the glucose 6-phosphate. But on another hand, in glucokinase where it is having the high Km value, so it will be the having the lower affinity. That means that if the glucose concentration is the very high, then only the glucokinase enzyme will be the acting enzyme in that case. So suppose we just had an food like in after meal, so in postprandial condition, most of the time the glucokinase enzyme will be the major enzyme which will be the acting on the glucose. And one important point is here, the glucose is induced by insulin hormone. So just remind the few things and open your brain. That suppose we just had a food, so in our body there will be the plenty of glucose. So if in the absence of insulin, what will be happen? So in the absence of insulin, we will become the diabetic. So in that case, the insulin will takes place, and it will induce the glucokinase to act on the glucose, so it can break down into the glucose 6-phosphate. And in resting, of course, we will be need of the energy. So what in that case, which enzyme will be the major enzyme to act on? So in that case, the hexokinase enzyme will be the major enzyme to the act on. So as I have said earlier, it utilize the ATP. So in the presence of ATP, the glucose will be converted into the glucose 6-phosphate under the enzymes hexokinase and the glucokinase. The glucose 6-phosphate have many phases, so that it can convert it into the glycogen by the glycogen synthesis, and it can also enter into the HMP pathway, and it can also enter into the uronic acid pathway, and it also can do the glycolysis that we are studying right now. So glucose 6-phosphate will be the converted into the fructose 6-phosphate. So let's see some significance of this, the first step of the glycolysis. So it is the first irreversible step. So it is the first irreversible step, and it is the also the flux generating step. And it uses the 1 ATP, and it commits glucose for the cellular metabolism, because the glucose alone can't take place in the cellular metabolism unless it don't convert it into the glucose 6-phosphate. So let's see the second step of the glycolysis, the glucose 6 phosphate, which will be the converted into the fructose 6 phosphate, which is the reversible reaction. So it will convert it into the fructose 6 phosphate under the enzyme that is the phosphohexose isomerase. Now this fructose 6 phosphate will be the converted into the fructose 1,6 bisphosphate. This is the irreversible step. Please note down. And under the enzyme that is the PFK, phosphofructose kinase 1, and it also utilize the ATP. So ATP will be converted into the ADP, of course. Let's see some significance of the third step of the glycolysis. So it is the second irreversible step, as I have said earlier, and it is the committed step. It is also known as the bottleneck of the pathway, and it is the rate limiting step. So why it known as the bottleneck of pathway and the committed step? Suppose we are having the enough ATP, enough energy in our body, so in that case we will be not needing any ATP. So if in that case, if we will generate the more and more ATP, that will be the harmful for ourselves, because we know that the only the adequate energy and adequate things we are always require inside our body. So in that step, if the ATP is higher in the body, so what happen? The PFK will not act, and it will not leads to the conversion of the fructose 6 phosphate into the fructose 1,6 bisphosphate. So that is why it is also known as the rate limiting step. So if you remember guys, I have said the preparatory phase also known as the stage of splitting. So why it is splitting? Suppose that there is the fructose 1,6 bisphosphate, which is the 6 carbon compound. It will be converted into the 3 carbon compounds. One is the dihydroxyacetone phosphate, that is the DHAP, which is the 3 carbon compound, and second one is the glyceraldehyde, which is the also reversible to the DHAP, of course. So glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate, which is also the 3 carbon compound, it will convert it under the enzyme that is the aldolase. So and the DHAP converted into glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate under the enzyme that is the phosphotriose isomerase. So till now we have discussed all the 5 steps of the preparatory phase. So now this glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate, which will convert it into the 1,3 bisphosphoglycerate, which will be enter into the payoff phase. So guys, now we will see the payoff phase, that is also in five in number. So what happens here? The glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate, which is 3 carbon compound, it will convert it into the 1,3 bisphosphoglycerate under the enzyme that is the glyceraldehyde 3 phosphodehydrogenase. Glyceraldehyde 3 phosphodehydrogenase under the this step will also generate the NADH from the NAD. So NAD will generate the NADH at the sixth step of the glycolysis, and the enzyme that is glyceraldehyde 3 phosphodehydrogenase will be inhibited by the iodoacetate and by the arsenate. So guys, what are the inhibitors of the glyceraldehyde 3 phosphodehydrogenase? They are the iodoacetate and the arsenate. So suppose there is a person which is drinking water from the agriculture sources, that is in which pesticides or fertilizers are frequently used. So what happens there? So because of the use of the pesticides and the fertilizers, there will be the plenty of arsenate in the that water, in that drinking water. So what happens there? So if he will consume the arsenate in drinking water, so what happen in that case? The sixth step, that is it will inhibit the glyceraldehyde 3 phosphodehydrogenase. So in that case, the glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate will not convert it into the 1,3 bisphosphoglycerate. So what happens? So I have mentioned earlier in the introduction part of this video that in any condition, if the glycolysis will not take place, because the glycolytic enzymes are the very important enzyme in the RBCs. So in that case, the inside the RBC, the glycolysis will not take place. So what happens there? So in that case, the hemolysis will take place of that person. Along with the hemolysis, the ATP generation will be so less. In fact, the nil. So now let's see the seventh step of the glycolysis. So this 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate will convert it into the 3-phosphoglycerate. So there is a removal of 180 under the enzyme, that is 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate kinase. So please note down, it is the only reversible kinase. So guys, please remind, we also studied the two more kinase initially, which were the irreversible kinase. So what were they? They were the glucokinase or the hexokinase, and second one was the PFK, that is the phosphofructose kinase, which were the irreversible kinase. So guys, in this step, the ADP will convert it into the ATP. So there is a generation of ATP, guys. Please note it down. There is a generation of ATP. Now we will call it as the substrate level phosphorylations. So now this phosphoglycerate will convert it into the 2-phosphoglycerate under the enzyme phosphoglycerate mutase. So this is the phosphoglycerate mutase, and this converted into the 2-phosphoglycerate. So there is just placing of phosphate group from third to second position. Now this 2-phosphoglycerate will convert it into the phosphoenol pyruvate under the enzyme enolase. The enolase enzyme will be inhibited by the fluoride. So and you know what? Fluoride present inside the water. So it converted into the PEP, that is a phosphoenol pyruvate. And now this phosphoenol pyruvate will convert it into the pyruvate, and this reaction is the irreversible one. So it converted into pyruvate under the enzyme, that is the pyruvate kinase. So it is also the kinase reaction, which is the irreversible one. And there is the generation of ATP from the ADP. So guys, can you now tell me what kind of phosphorylation it is? It is also the substrate level phosphorylation, because it is taking place inside the cytoplasm, not in the mitochondria. So guys, if you remember, there will be the generation of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate at the step number 5th and the 4th. So if you remember guys, the glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, which were converted from the fructose 1,6-bisphosphate at the number 4th step, and from the 5th step, it also can be converted from the DHAP, from the dihydroxyacetone phosphate, which were the reversible reaction. So in that case, the glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, first it formed from the fructose 1,6-bisphosphate, and secondly it is formed from the DHAP. So now if we sum up them, so there will be the generation of 2-glyceraldehyde-3-phosphate, first one from the fructose 1,6-bisphosphate, and second one from the DHAP. So guys, now we are having 2-glyceraldehyde-3-phosphate. So in this case, there will be the repetition of payoff phase two times, that is the twice, for each glyceraldehyde-3-phosphate. So guys, now we are having 2-glyceraldehyde-3-phosphate. So the NADH produce, how many NADH produce? It also produce the twice. And how many ATP? It will also produce the twice. And here also it also produce the twice. So guys, now we will see the oxidative phosphorylation, means what is the fate of NADH, and we will see the substrate level phosphorylation also. The oxidative phosphorylation, the 1-ADH produce the 2.5 ATPs, and there is the generation of 2-NADH as we just studied. So how many generation of ATP? 5 ATPs. So 2-NADH will produce the 5 ATP. At what step? At step number 6. At step 6. So now we will see the substrate level phosphorylation, at which step they occurred. Substrate level phosphorylation. So the total ATP produced were the 4. How many? 4. At what steps? At step 7 and 10. And how many ATP we utilized? We utilized the two ATPs at step 1 and 3rd. So we utilize the two ATPs. So guys, what will be the net ATP? The net ATP will be the 2, that is 4 minus 2 is 2. So now we are studying the anaerobic glycolysis. So anaerobic glycolysis, so the glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate, which is the 3 carbon compound, which converted into the 1,3 bisphosphoglycerate under the enzyme, that is the glyceraldehyde 3 phosphodehydrogenase, and under the presence of inorganic phosphate, it will utilize the NAD and will generate the NADH. So there is the generation of NADH at the that level. So this NADH generation will take place here. Now there is the there is a forming of the 1,3 bisphosphoglycerate, and this will ultimately will convert it into the pyruvate, because we just see the glycolysis can take place in anaerobic and aerobic both conditions. So in anaerobic conditions, this will also generate pyruvate as the aerobic one. So now this will generate the pyruvate. Now what happened to this pyruvate? Now under the lack of oxygen, it will convert it into the lactate. So it will convert it into the lactate under the which enzyme? Under the LDH enzyme, that is the lactate dehydrogenase. So guys, what happens here? The NADH which were generated during the glycolysis will convert it again back to the NAD. So because of that, there is a no generation of NADH. So there is a no net generation of NADH. The one we have generated during the glycolysis, which also be consumed when pyruvate converted into the lactate. So there is a no generation of NADH. So guys, now we will see the energetics of these reactions, the anaerobic glycolysis and the glycolysis. So what are the energies produced? So during the aerobic glycolysis, let's see, we have generated the 2 NADH and 2 net ATP. So the total ATP was the 7 ATP, and during the anaerobic glycolysis, the net generation of NADH was 0. So NADH is 0 plus 2 net ATP. So what were the total ATPs? They are the 2 ATPs. So guys, now we will see some clinical correlation of the glycolysis, because why we are reading glycolysis? For the clinical purpose now. So let's see. So pyruvate kinase deficiency is the second most common enzyme deficiency in humans. So it is the most common one. And what it causes? It causes hemolysis. So it causes hemolysis. And second one, the aldolase A deficiency. And what it leads to cause? It also leads to cause the hemolysis. And PFK, so the muscle PFK1 deficiency, what will it cause? It will cause the exercise intolerance. So it causes the exercise intolerance. So guys, if you like my content, then please like this video and share this video to your colleagues through your WhatsApp group or Instagram. So love you guys, and please do not forget to subscribe my channel. Thank you so much. Bye.